CMB. CMB. Man, we all we got.
It's Military Pride Month at Spectrum News One, and this morning we're taking a closer look at what our service members face after they return home from war.
A veteran U.S. Army sergeant is highlighting the experience of veterans with the movie.
As U.S. Army veteran Chris Bray gets into hair and makeup, he says that unlike these wounds, he hopes his film shines a light on the wounds we don't always get to see.
So you want to make a movie, huh?
Welcome to The Making of Trauma, a CMB Studios original documentary. We take you behind the scenes and show you how we made this movie. Zero budget, everything paid out of my pocket. This is the story of how we made Trauma, a CMB Studios original feature film. Written, directed, produced by yours truly. It was chickens everywhere. Just cluck, 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 chickens everywhere. Now, I don't know about you, but if you're not from the country life like myself, all y'all city folk out there, it could shake you up. So not only were my cameramen shook up when they first arrived.
Well, I'm gonna tighten up.
But the cast was shook up when they first arrived. Now, the chickens are friendly. They ain't gonna bother nobody. They wanna chew, chew, chew. You know, move around the yard a little bit. Ain't nothing going on but pimping. You understand me?
Going in peace, she's my Uncle Gene right here. Mr. Man.
Nice to meet you.
Yes, sir. You know the cabin's unlocked, or was the key in the back, or you?
See, at the back door, she said something about she left it unlocked last night, I think.
Okay.
Then I got a key to it.
All right.
So Trauma was filmed in Axton, Virginia. It's a small town right in near Martinsville, Virginia. My aunt, Mariana, she allowed us to film on her property.
Hello, darling.
I've seen this cabin since I was a child. I used to go out there and do a little work with her and with the family and everything. It's farmland, very rural, gritty, has that country feel to it. And that's what I was looking for Travis, the main character, Elijah Travis's home.
Travis's bathroom. Should be the kitchen right here. This is that stove I was telling y'all about. Exactly.
I didn't want him to come from money. I didn't want him to come from, you know, a happy place. I wanted to show what the struggle can really be like for a veteran that comes home and has to find out how to survive financially and how to survive mentally. We were there 5 days. First day we arrived, I immediately grabbed the camera guys. Shout out PC, Patrick Connor, who's directing this documentary. Shout out Nolan DeBerry, shout out Jay Red, shout out Selena Spring, the crew that we had. Besides myself, this crew, this was actually their first film.
All right, let's get ready to go shoot, man. Let's get ready to shoot. Father, thank you for having us here. Me and you just talked this morning. I really need you this week, knocking this film out, getting this story out for the veterans who are not heard and the things that we go through upon returning after military service. Big Dog, look after us today. Look after us through this whole production. And just guide us through a smooth production process and a smooth post-production process, God. Protect everybody, keep them safe. Keep COVID up out of here. And, you know, guide the actors, guide the talent, guide myself as a director to guide this story to where it needs to be, and that's the promised land, all right? Heavenly Father, thank you for all that you've done. Thank you for bringing us here. Thank you for this creativity. Thank you for this craft. Thank you for this idea, this story. Let's rock and roll, goddamn. Amen.
I couldn't afford to hire a film crew, 9 departments. We had to makeshift with makeup. Shout out to Selena with makeup. PC and Nolan basically handled the production when I was on set and I was in character. And PC was the camera operator who I trusted to get behind the camera, camera A, and capture the beautiful shots that we captured cinematically.
Scene 12A, take 2. Audio. Camera A, rolling. And action.
While on set, if I was in the scene, I was able to communicate to PC the angle I wanted, the shot composition, and emotionally what we were going for according to the script. So that first day we arrived, not only did I want to share my scouting report, but I also wanted to implement, you know, what we're looking for story-wise.
Y'all just stopped talking and shit. You ready?
Yeah, I'm ready. I've been rolling,
man. Oh, my bad. So this next shot, right, we're coming out of the bathroom. We're coming into the kitchen. Like I said before, it's a lot of sharp objects, a lot of leading lines. It's a lot of chaotic. It's a chaotic environment in here. So what we want is everything to be interesting and intricate, not boring and plain. All right? So, P, you in that corner. Take a knee for me, sir. Yes, sir. What we're looking at is perspective. Now, make your rectangle for me. Bingo. Find the fridge through the chairs. So we're shooting from underneath there, capturing all that's going on. Now, on the flip side of that, P, if you come over here for me. So from this angle, right, so instead of shooting a symmetrical, peaceful shot, we want to throw the angle off about 45 and then capture Travis coming in on the phone right there. It looks more interesting. And sometimes you may not be able to catch my eyes, you see what I'm saying? Using these lines and all the lines that we have in here, vertical, horizontal, above, below, using everything.
Morning. This is my first entry for the director's diary. Yesterday we finished production day 1 of 5. It was mostly transport shots. Actually my character Travis, the crew, we got to get warmed up, I guess you say, was where we got warmed up at and got to see how things would taste for the rest of the day. Excellent job on the transport shots. I was able to get in the character for the first time and really be in my environment. We were just able to, you know, collectively see how we're going to put this together. And we got a lot done. Day 1 was a lot, but day two almost took me over the edge.
Today, day 2, we've already ran into some weather problems.
We ran into weather issues, tornado issues, and, you know, dealing with, you know, scheduling on the fly, downloading on the fly. We had to set up a makeshift office in the living room.
So day 2, this is where we get nitty gritty, especially this evening with our night scenes. I'm really excited for those and, you know, finally getting the cast up here. Day 2, drama.
We actually stayed in my grandmother's house. The reason why I chose my grandmother's house for lodging is simply because I wanted the cast and crew, particularly the cast, to feel uncomfortable. It's hard for me to get on set and ask somebody who just had Starbucks for breakfast and a 3-course meal for breakfast to act like they're in rural America and they're dealing with mental issues and they're dealing with a crazy, you know, army vet. It's hard to do that. So my grandmother's house had no Wi-Fi. No air conditioning outside in that main lobby. There were barely any pillows. We all shared one shower, so it was 10 people in one shower, one at a time. Sometimes that water got cold, but at the end of the day, when we got on set, I could tell that edge that I wanted from my cast as a director, it was definitely there.
All right, you ready?
Yep.
All right, cool. All right, so welcome. This is 162 Hobson Road. This is headquarters. You guys are the first bunch of actors we have come through. Yesterday, we only had one actor. He did an amazing job. The guy was very seasoned, had the great look with everything. Just amazing, a pleasure to work with. So today, we got pushed back with tornado warning this morning. We were really supposed to film at like 7 a.m. right at sunrise for his character. We couldn't. So what we're doing is we're going to fit him in right before we go to our day scenes, which are at Travis's house. We try to stay in order from the call sheet because that schedule is designed for a purpose. This is my grandmother's house. She passed away a couple years ago, so my aunt owns it now. This room right here is where we're at, all right? And here's the TV. I'll set up the PS5. If you are going to be here and you're not in scene, please be rehearsing, resting. We don't want any partying or no smoking indoors. Clean up after yourself. Please clean up after yourself. Everything down here is country. My aunt don't have Wi-Fi here, no internet here. So I had to go buy Verizon Wi-Fi. Come to find out, Verizon got no damn satellites out here. So it's been that type of week. Yesterday, we shot at such a high contrast with the shadows and the compositions, you really couldn't tell. It was so dark in the shots that we shot. All right, so what we're doing is, because we have all green talent, green means you guys are new. It's gonna be ready. That means you guys are still developing, still learning the craft and everything. Myself as well, it helped me out. It's a handicap. We're gonna overexpose or get as bright as we can, and then use our ND filters to provide this, to bring the light to where it's not blown out. So if you guys are in a scene and you may be thinking, man, it's dark in here, can they see me? We can see the fuck out of you. You know what I'm saying? We're shooting for emotion.
The next morning, set call was usually between 6 or 7 a.m. And that was where I would make sure that we had breakfast. We would wake up, I would go over the agenda for the day, what scenes we were covering, what time we would be at headquarters, which was my grandma Katie's house, and then also what we'd be doing in the travel plan for the day, just to keep everybody informed. Coming from my military background, one lesson that I had to learn is that not everybody is able to withstand exhaustion, mental exhaustion, physical exhaustion. And that is what we experienced on the set. I only had this group of people for 5 days, and our day-by-day planning was according to scenes and according to, you know, I tried to get those who I could get out in one day, out as fast as possible. But everybody else who was, you know, had multiple scenes, you were there. And 6 a.m. wake up, and we film throughout the day, we film throughout the night, get done around 1 or 2 o'clock in the morning, cast and crew would shower, I would download footage, peep footage. You know, we probably go to sleep around 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock in the morning.
Fuck you looking at?
Bruh. I'm getting B-roll. For a documentary.
I know that.
What is it? How does the sound go?
I can't do it right now.
21 to 42. On top of those right hands up in 63. 103 scenes in there. We still got Monday.
Word.
Yeah, Monday we should knock anything out. What's left over. But tomorrow we're going to be pumping and humping.
Y'all not fried?
Nah, I'm pretty fried.
Do I look like a
1 to 10, how high are you?
Deep into the lens.
I would say like probably like a 7. Yeah.
Hey, it's killing him, right?
That's gonna be a great cut. Right there.
I'm trying to figure out life right now.
I'm trying to get to her, bro.
That's not how you treat our documentary.
Yeah, come on, bro. Don't switch the documentary, bro.
Right.
Oh, good night, man. I am tired. You hear me? Tired. I mean, I gotta be up in 2 hours.
Good night.
She's going crazy. You gonna get a fucking
First of all, when you do a production, you have to have chemistry. You have to have chemistry. If you think you're gonna show up and just shoot a cast full of first-time actors on a movie screen, a crew full of first-time on set, you have to develop chemistry. And that's where my particular directing style came into play. The sleeping arrangements on site, because headquarters, my grandmother's house, was only 5 minutes away from where we were shooting at, it definitely helped. If I had to send everybody home instead of them sleeping on site, I'm not guaranteed the same person the next day.
I wonder, did he know he was gonna make a hit? Like, I wonder if he knew this shit was a hit.
You probably trying to catch yourself.
Casting was done about 3 to 4 months before, in which I was able to meet the cast in person during rehearsals, see what they brought to the characters I had selected for them or casted them for, and then also see what type of range they could carry. The initial rehearsal, I knew it would be a challenge because the script that I wrote was very particular about delivery of certain sentences or sequences, and I wanted to make sure the cast understood the importance of lines.
And action.
He's here, in town. Leonard.
All right, let's try this right here.
Behind the scenes.
What's up, vlog?
My man in character. behind the scenes.
Yo, holding the light, doing what I do best.
Well, surely.
We do, so my roommate might do that sometimes.
Travis, what? Can you hear me?
All right, from the top. And action.
Travis, can you hear me?
Oh,
From the top. That's why I told y'all, guys, rest of the day, know your lines. Everybody, know your lines. You've had lines for almost 2 months now. Know your lines.
Now, this is a common mistake by first-time actors. And they say, well, if I don't say it word by word, is that cool? And one thing that I've always been a stickler on is the script is there for a reason. And the way that I write is I hide gems, I hide details, I leave subliminal messages. So it's important for, you know, the actor or actress to understand that every word in that script is important. So for certain characters, I allowed some leeway. But for other characters and sequences, I made sure that it was word by word because I knew it had to pay off in the storyline.
We're on break right now. It's about 3:30, 4 o'clock. 2:30, 3 o'clock, my bad. For our crew and its immediate cast. Reason being the scheduling and getting our shooting schedule locked in for the night. Got a ton of night scenes to get in tonight. Ton of night scenes. If we get these in, we should be set up straight. We're good to go.
Directing, shooting, and acting all at once, and managing your production is a serious, serious responsibility. One thing that I didn't know about was being able to switch back and forth between director, actor, producer, camera operator, set designer. It took a lot. It really, really, really took a lot.
Here we go, quiet on set. Hey, cut the music off. What the fuck are y'all doing, man?
It's time to turn up, man. Come on, get your fiend ass down here, man.
Dude, what are they doing in here?
Why wouldn't they be in here, D?
I don't know, neither one of them. But this is my house.
Bro,
you come here as a leisure of me. You don't bring no fucking girls in my house. Bro,
come on, bro. Let's have a good time, bro. You worry about the wrong shit, bro. Come on.
I worry about the right fucking shit. You're in my fucking house.
Bro, that's all you do is get fucked up. Why not? What's changed now?
Bro, don't try to get pumped because the girls is here, man. Bro, I don't know now. I don't want neither one of them, man.
Bro,
I want to fuck at my house.
Bro, listen. Why the fuck you worried about that shit, bro?
SC, great job.
Yo.
So I'm giving y'all songs of what the vibe should be.
Yeah,
about two or three songs that we can feel it before we actually go into it.
Yeah, both of them bass and dick. Yeah, shaking the ass and tail.
Show me what
the calendar. 20 M's and nigga, I think I'm original. 2 M's and real estate. Gotta buy me some more. I ain't got no list of that night with the baddest bitch. Yeah, I can get it 100% if I'm feeling her. Yeah, both of them bass and dick. Yeah, shaking the ass and tail.
No,
I'm not eating the past for cities. I heard a few to blame, but with Monique, I'm shit she playing.
All right, cool. So what we just did was we're working on our voice tone and also how we talking. That was perfect what you did.
Quiet on set. Pictures up. Scene 45, take one. Audio.
Speed.
Camera A.
Rolling.
And action.
Yo, time to turn up. Who taking it first? Don't be shy now.
I've been ready, baby. It's been a long weekend.
All right, so it's been a long day, baby. You should be able to go underneath his arm, grab it, and then come in here resting your head on it.
And, you know, on set, I knew my character was a dark, dark character, a substance abuser, a military vet. And physically, through the makeup department, we were able to, you know, give this look of what Travis looked like. But I knew I had to get into a zone mentally of what Travis would feel, what emotion am I conveying, what am I doing for this scene, what am I trying to convey to the audience. And that is where we actually pushed the limit. So on set, you'll see here in this documentary that we didn't shy away from rolling a blunt here and there. We didn't shy away from drinking a beer here and there. I knew it was imperative to get the job done, but at the same time, physically, my character required me to be in a certain physical state.
Ain't nothing much going on, boys. I got doing what I got to do, man. Every single fucking day, man. Just hanging out. Me and my buddy, PC.
Yeah, getting her done. Yeah,
he's one of my good colored friends. Not for a little bit.
And then,
Kyrie.
My favorite barber.
He's my only, colored cousin. He was dropped on his head as a baby. That's why it's a bit swell up.
We're not going to talk about that. You promised. You promised you wouldn't bring that up.
Daggone it.
That's just the truth of it. So not only was I able to get this production done with the team that I have, and we got it done, but at the same time, I was doing it with multiple personalities, if you will. So I had to play serious director, serious producer, had to be the writer, make sure the words are right. And on the flip side of that, I also had to do was be the character, the main character, who I had written for. A military vet who was trapped in his head, confined by his PTSD, a frantic substance abuser, heroin addict, an abusive husband, and a father who had lost his children. This is what you have to do in this independent filmmaking world.
Time check. Time is officially 12:38. Don't know if y'all can see that.
Oh, fuck.
Oh, shit.
Hell yeah, what time did we wake up? 6?
We woke up, we started filming at like 7. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? We just got done, it's 12:40. I ain't see that shit, it was 12:40 though. This is day 3?
Day 3 of the bed
day runs. 3, this is day 3 of shooting.
Oh, yeah.
Today we got a buck ass wild day. Fuck.
Alright,
anyways.
Nah, for real though. Good day. Good day 3. Got the good scenes we wanted to get. You know, got the interesting shit. You know, things that's gonna hook you guys into this one for real.
Yeah, we got drunk and nasty too.
Yeah.
So yeah,
but yeah, we got a cool ass cast. Everyone's chilling at the crib right now. We on the Bev Run. We necessity. Quick 30-minute, you know, recap. Yeah. But we'll pick it up when we get the Bevs.
Oh, and now my shit's like, where the fuck the AD card go?
I'm like, so, like, she.
Yeah, give me like a.
She.
Give me like a.
Migo.
Migo.
Give me a.
Nah, do a brr, like
a brr,
like
a push. Oh, that, hold on.
Give me a Lucci.
Do it again.
That was it.
That was it,
bro. Yeah. Cut. Yo. Day 4.
Oh,
day 4.
Yeah, we're supposed to be up at like 4:30.
What time check? Time check.
10:30.
What's going on over here?
My birthday vlog.
Vlog. Oh,
what?
Alright then, shit.
Sunday shooting.
He's making grunts, you know what I'm saying? Right. It's like he's pissed off his girl's not back yet.
Alright.
Huh?
First scenes of the day.
Yo.
Shut my phone and tell you I have
to. Yeah, come in. Come in pissed off in the face.
Okay.
And then walk around the bed to over here to the window to about right here. And then check your phone. Alright.
Where is she?
Stay right there. Fuck, man. And action.
Damn. Where is she at?
All right, go to the middle of the hallway. Back up, guys, back up.
We're back. We're waiting on everyone with the Bohonglies. We just finished up at
the American Legion Post in Mayodan, North Carolina.
Boom, you heard it here first. But we got probably 20 more scenes. We're going to get like 80% done today. We're going to charge all the batteries. And we going to chill. And I don't have any more weed. Fuck you, PC. I hope you see this. And you are the one that stressing. We'll pick up whenever these niggas decide to show up with the food.
Facts.
Peace.
Little vlog update. We got more shit to get organized. We'll see if it works.
Behind the scenes. What's going on?
TP, aka Leo.
Yeah.
That nigga.
Yep.
What's going on? What it is, what it ain't, what it does, what it can't.
This nigga, yeah. Bro.
I think they had one senior.
Bump is out.
Look at Travis. He's still in character.
And as a first year coach.
You need to get out of character.
I ain't in nothing. I'm in the sky right now.
Oh,
what did you do?
I let go of that curve. Oh, shit. We gotta get out of here.
Oh, God. Oh, God. How about losing that film?
Once we filmed Trauma and we were on rap day, I think we finished at the cabin. And there's a clip of me, Nolan, and the guys on the front porch, and we celebrated. In the back of my head, I was relieved that we had finished filming. You know, principal photography, we were done. But at the same time, there was a piece of worry in the back of my mind because I kind of was finally seeing what I was getting myself into. So, you know, over 5 days of filming, 8 to 10 terabytes of footage, 101 scenes, 100 pages of script, multiple takes, unlabeled audio files. I think there were close to 400 audio files that we had recorded separately from the camera. I kinda had the gist that, hey, it's about to get real in this post-production and this editing bay. After we had finished filming the film, that was the hardest part of this whole process for me. I didn't prepare myself to shed myself of the character and return to who I was in reality. I had never acted before. And, you know, me being completely honest with the PTSD and the things that I experienced in the military and what I have mentally going on, it was very challenging. One upfront truth, if you're an independent filmmaker, is that when you put all your, you know, your faith into your project, you know, your money has to back it. So all my personal finances went into the making of Trauma. Not only was I trying to shed a character and get back to reality, but I was also trying to juggle finances. I'm also a father of two. I was trying to balance household duties. I'm also a barber, my professional career. And it was a lot. Not only did I have to do that, but also I'm still in the editing bay. I'm the main editor. I'm very proud of myself. I'm very proud of my team. I'm very proud of every single failure I had. I'm very proud of every single failure I had. I'm proud of every single success that I had. And I'm proud of the process in which we went through to make Trauma, because it taught me lessons. Valuable lessons as a filmmaker, whether good or bad. I learned what it takes to make a film. Insides and out, every single position, every part of production, I learned every piece by making Trauma. So reshoot day one was at an abandoned hospital in Yakinville. And I'm thankful for the film commissioner for, you know, showing me the location and referring me over. The reason why I rented the hospital is because I wanted to beef up, you know, the script a little bit, provide something more than just rural Virginia. And for what Travis was going through with the psychiatrist and our dialogue back and forth, I knew that it was imperative that we had the hospital look. I wanted Travis to be placed in the rehab. I wanted the audience to see what Travis would be going through. So when we shot at this hospital, it was December. It was cold as crap because the heat wasn't on this place. Just imagine a hospital that everybody left except the furniture.
love is a mild and he's a son in the rain. Take a little bit, just with a whole lot of pain.
I'm thankful because with the heat not being on, we were still able to shoot and creatively find ways to display what we wanted to on screen. And with the hospital scenes, man, it really brought the movie to life. It really brought the movie to life.
Report, I'm gonna report back in like 20 minutes.
Damn, you trying to wake me back up again?
Oh, yeah. It's the one,
All right, hold on.
Look at me. Peeing weightlifting class.
Slow, and you're gonna drag your car to a nice, soft halt. And it should end like right here. You see what I'm saying? The full shot. Look at you. It might be the opening shot of the movie, buddy.
Heather Jane, she plays a psychiatrist in the film.
Hi.
Therapist, doctor, what?
Yeah. All the above.
All the above.
Let's go with psychotherapist.
Psychotherapist.
Yeah.
We're going to go with that.
All right, Carmen, take a half step to the right for me. Right, half step right there. Perfect. Mm-hmm. All right, you're going to turn your body inside, Dr. G. Turn your body inside right there. And then while you're talking, you're going to have one of these talks. You're going to have one of these. Left arm up right there, boom. And you're going to talk back first. All right, so as they're talking at first, we're going to use this angle right here. For some reason, I like this. What is it on, 24?
You're everybody's favorite dope fiend / director. Know what happens when you got pee behind the camera, man.
When y'all are talking, don't turn to the side. More like when you're reacting, that's when you turn to the side. Just for ADR purposes.
Sure.
Take a half step forward for me, Dr. G. Right. Young. Perfect. And cut.
Thing about that.
He ain't let us know that none of that was going on. He says, popped out, grab this shot. I'm finna do some crazy shit. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I thought what he was doing, he was gonna hang himself. Nigga script butt naked.
Hey, we do an interview for the production. I got something to talk about now.
Oh, yeah, I'm talking shit.
Oh, yeah, I'm talking shit.
I'm talking cash.
Nigga took us outside, right?
Told us the whole time we getting just feet. We getting the hanging scene. We getting just feet. Cut.
My boy J Red, at a fashion guru.
Ah, yeah.
Yeah, they ain't know that.
They know now.
You know what I'm saying? We got the poster film for motherfucking PTSD. I'm telling you.
P, can we get a light check on the camera real quick? Find out how much light they add. P, got the thing right there.
And also, sure, we did a short casting call where I was asking for extras. And there were people who drove out of their way to be in the film, and I am tremendously thankful for. And we were able to get a lot of great footage shot. And just the location itself, you'll see in the film the long hallway scene. You'll see Travis trying to break out. You'll see a lot of creative stuff that I've actually wanted to put in film that I hadn't been able to do. But me being the main actor, I can tell myself pretty much what I want to see on screen.
How's it feel being behind the camera, P?
Feels natural.
Just feel like another day, guys.
Just feels like another day at the office. You know what I'm saying? Check that out right there.
Let me reiterate about the set design. Selena.
All right, cool. So this will work for the entrance shot. After you do the entrance shot and I sit down, then we'll regroup and then bring it over the shoulder to capture him.
It was easier to shoot because I knew what we had already shot and I seen it on screen. I had seen it in the editing bay, but it also became more challenging because in my head, as a perfectionist, as a competitor, as an artist, as a creative, I wanted everything to be perfect. So we went to these new locations, you know, I was trying to do more with what I had than was actually supposed to be done. And I learned a very, very, very valuable lesson with that as well. If you're not prepared to shoot, if you haven't planned it, if you don't have the proper equipment, don't try to just wing it on set. It ain't gonna go right. But when you get back to the editing bay and you see amazing shot after amazing shot after amazing shot, it gives you the inspiration and motivation to keep going and finish the project. So I was definitely pleased with how we reshot and the environment, the chemistry, the fun we had. It was December. It was the World Cup time. Messi won a World Cup at this time. That was our last day reshooting at the hospital when Messi won the World Cup. So it was definitely like a whole vibe.
And we're back on behind the scenes.
Friday, February 3rd. Friday, February 3rd. Trauma, one night special premiere at Carolina Theater.
Yeah.
Regular tickets are $25. VIP are $100 tickets. But I got a surprise for y'all to come VIP.
Ooh.
60 Sex. Tickets available. Only 60.
Premiere night. The process of planning a premiere. Independent filmmakers, it is very, very important that you pay attention on this part. I stepped into this process of, instead of me just having a film and putting it on YouTube or a film and putting it on Tubi, which Trauma will never be on Tubi or YouTube, it was imperative to me that I have a big bang. We put all this work into Trauma, all these people's lives are involved in the making of Trauma, and I was so proud of the cast and crew that I wanted to pay them off, pay them back somehow, some way. And in my mind, if I'm gonna do something, I'm gonna go big, or I'm gonna take my yellow ass on to the house. So we went big. I got on Google, looked around, and the first thing that popped up was Carolina Theater. The theater itself is so beautiful, historic. It's it's a landmark in the city of Greensboro. And a lot of famous acts over decades, over the years, over the history of Greensboro have performed there. And in my mind, I was like, hey, I deserve to be there as well.
March 30th, there's a concert up there already.
We discussed pricing, we discussed all the good stuff. I left there. And as I said before, I'm still financially strapped. But I knew I had to premiere at the Carolina Theater.
Now, I wanted to ask you as far as how to talk to the choir.
Yeah.
It says on the thing that it comes through here.
Yes, it has to.
Gotcha. Now, what brands or what provider do you guys use?
Well, I mean, we have five different types of wine, so it just depends. And we can get something special if you want that.
Okay.
And we can work that out.
During this process, I'm still editing. I still got clips. I don't know what the movie looks like. We're in January now, going from December, going into 2023. I booked the date for February 3rd, 2023, at the end of November, 2022.
I mean, it's not $100 a bottle of wine. Okay. It's not $7 a bottle.
December goes by. I'm still editing. January goes by. I'm still editing. I edit around the clock all the way up until February 2nd at 4 p.m. I exported that night. It was a 12-hour export. The next morning I woke up, February 3rd, the movie was ready. Now, when you do find a location, you complete the process, you do the legal stuff, you have the paperwork, it's very, very important that you understand that there's a process that you go through with the hosting theater. You too, I appreciate it.
Oh, not a problem. You like one-star shopping?
Yeah.
Okay, if you don't mind, there's a table out here.
Yes, sir, sure.
Thank
you. Yeah, the moment you all been waiting for, the moment you all been waiting for, I am going to introduce, give him a chance to cue it back there. This is a CMB Studios premiere, written, directed, and produced by Christopher Bray. Ladies and gentlemen, I bring to you Trump.
Don't lie to me and don't lie to her.
Why are you just now saying something?
Correct. You're a smart man.
300 heads in seats, 300 tickets sold. Nobody left, nobody was upset, nobody fell asleep, nobody got up and walked out. I watched the entire film. I watched people watch the entire film.
Coming to the stage, the director, producer, and writer of CMB Studios Original, Trauma. I bring to you Mr. Christopher Bray!
I'm gonna go down the list and say thank you to some people. I wanna thank, first of all, I wanna thank all the veterans in the house. If you're a veteran, please stand up, please. Please stay standing. Real quick, you guys look around, what you see is, you see human beings that saw something in themselves and sacrificed it so that everybody else here can have the freedoms that they have. And they're still dealing with the effects of their service even after they get out. So to every veteran here that came out of support, the ones that dressed up, the ones that's cool and casual, thank you for being here tonight. I love each and every one of y'all. Thank y'all.
The Triad Minority Business Network, they were huge as well. And it was just collectively, I was getting love from businesses in the community. Minority business were pouring into this premiere night and it made it special. Very, very. I'm thankful to my family, my mom and dad who helped me plan this well. And then Ultimate Sacrifice, Miss Jasmine Hoyle. Jasmine Hoyle, thank you so much. Her and her companies were the main sponsor for our first premiere. And that is somebody who I consider a true friend of CMB, has supported CMB Studios since, you know, the first day that we actually met. And I'm just, you know, forever thankful to Jasmine Hoyle and her team and her company as well. But
I don't know if y'all know or not, but this filmmaking industry is expensive. It's expensive, man. I'm a barber and I'm a filmmaker, so I ain't got a million yet. So I want to say thank you to all of our sponsors, The Ultimate Sacrifice, and Ms. Jasmine Hoyle and her team. This is Dwayne Jones, president of the Jet Black and Common Foundation. We got Super Barbershop Chase Lewis, right in the middle, all my barbers in the middle. Yes, indeed. indeed, yes indeed. London Residential LLC, my cousin Letitia Milner, who also contributed. The Triad Minority Business and Women's Expo, Mr. Reginald McCaskill and his wife. Thank you all for your contribution and supporting me since I met you. I love you, brother. Next, I want to give a thank you to my family, my mom and dad and everybody that's here, and also my extended family. Y'all came all the way from the country out here. Thank you. I really appreciate it, all right? Cast, can you stand up, please? Cast and crew, stand up, please. Everybody involved, I want to say thank you from the bottom of my heart. When you first did auditions, when you first said yes to the job, when you first came on set, all the way through the end, thank y'all from the bottom of my heart. What you guys did for me in this production, I will never forget, and I love each and every one of y'all. All right? Thank y'all. Seriously, thank y'all.
We love you, Chris!
Twin City Catering Company. Twin City Catering Company. Lord have mercy. You saved my life last year. I was proud of the cast, who arrived dressed to the nines. The crew, who at first said, I don't wanna wear a tux, I don't wanna wear a suit, I don't want, they showed up dressed to the nines.
We chuckled about it, I thought about it.
And to see the cast and crew happy, appreciated as artists, as creatives, I think so far that has been my biggest payoff yet from Trauma. Because in this area, in the industry, you don't really get shown love like that, honest, true love for what you create until you really make it. And that night, I got to see cast, crew, everybody from Trauma, genuinely appreciated by the audience that showed out.
I know that you know, they can't deny you.
Right now, we're actually going into our second and final premiere.
Back at it again. Yours truly behind the camera once again. Got one of the star actors right here. Road trip type vibes, as you can see.
And to be honest, if you know me, you know how competitive I am. And if I'ma do something and put that CMB stamp on there, that CMB studio stamp, and directed by CMB, it has to be perfect. So after premiere night, I watched Trauma 1,000 times, just over and over and over and over and over again, because I wanted to go in and pick out the mistakes.
Alright, you're gonna track in just behind him. Alright, now on your orbits, I can't have this. So you orbit around him a turn, I can't have it where it's uneven, it's a quick jump. So I need a smooth turn and then capture him. Is it on? Damn, it's so cold. Come here, land against the other corner. Everybody's behind you.
What's the artist's name?
Nah, it's a movie.
Huh?
It's a movie.
It's a movie?
Yeah.
Are we out the shot? We just stay out here? Just stay out here?
Yeah, because we're orbiting. If you're going to be inside, go to the corner. All right,
bet. That's a bad
corner
over there.
Go down.
Yo, you gotta
pictures up, and action.
I'm gonna say that they're gonna watch the TV for 10 seconds. Why? Because we're cutting to what we just shot.
This is the Delano and Travis wide shot, take one. And action.
With this next premiere, we've teamed up with somebody who I looked up to in this area, who I admired his journey, and that's Will Dalton. Will Dalton is a seasoned actor from Hollywood Productions, the big boy stuff, you see what I'm saying? Very, very talented actor. Somebody who I think takes the craft seriously and is a committed artist to acting. And he hit me up, hey brother, I love your style. Could you shoot this film for me? I got it written. It's a crazy story. You know how Will get excited about stuff. So I said, sure, man. And at that time, I didn't know if I wanted to take on another project because I was still watching Trauma and still adding to it, taking away that type of deal. But when I read his script, I said, oh yeah, I got to shoot this. And it's Will Dalton. So we shot that. And after that, I said, hey, bro, I showed out with this camera. We showed out in this production. Let's do a dual premiere. You know, we're both in the same community. We're both minorities. I got a name now. I got some weight with this film stuff. You have a name in the acting world. Let's team up. Let's make this happen. So we agreed to go ahead and do a dual premiere. And the dual premiere, the date for the dual premiere will be, and Will was just a great person. You know, Will, the way that, you know, we came about this project. And it's gonna show March. I forgot. We were also teaming up with Tiffany and her company, Page to Film, and her nonprofit, which has helped out tremendously. She basically stepped in and said, Chris, Will, I'll take over the planning responsibilities, me and my team, so you can focus on the creative side. So right now, I'm still editing Soulmates. I'm almost done with it. It is perfection. And right now, we're ready. The last step of Trauma, the few add-in scenes, and this bad boy is ready to ride. And we're going to premiere two monster movies. One short is called Soulmates, written and directed by Will Dalton. Trauma, full feature-length movie, 1 hour and 50 minutes, written and directed by yours truly. And you can buy VIP tickets or general admission. General admission, I think, is like $19.99, and the VIP tickets this year, this premiere, we're going to have celebrities there and a very private crowd. So the VIP tickets now are at $150 a piece.
For me, all right. All right, Pete, go ahead and calm it down.
You want to make a movie? I mean, really, really, you really want to make a movie? You got this idea in your head. You keep having dreams about a storyline. You want to make a movie? Okay. Find out what you want to do in the filmmaking industry. Me personally, I always wanted to be a director. My favorite directors are Spike Lee, Quentin Tarantino, Aaron Sorkin, Ava DuVernay, you know, just to name a few, Steven Spielberg, of course. But instead of watching the rewards and the harvest of their hard work, the movies, I've done that for years. I wanted to go back. And this is what I advise all those who want to make film. Go back and learn their process. Learn their creative process. Learn their techniques. Learn their directing style. You know, how are you going to interact with actors? How are you going to shepherd the story? Because a director is not somebody who just sits in a chair with a name on the back. A director is somebody who's able to lead cast and crew, the entire production, and get the story in which they see it in their head. You see what I'm saying? A director is the shepherd of the story. If you want to make a film and you're serious about it, forget about having all the money in the world. Pick you up a camera, make a story, shoot it, edit it, put it together the best you can. Show it. That's your first film. Put your name on there. Put directed by and your name. Just get the first one out the way. My next piece of advice to anybody who wants to get into filmmaking is to understand the business side of it. Tyler Perry doesn't get where he's at without understanding the business side of filmmaking. So before you order that chair on Amazon that says director on the back, or before you wear that goofy hat on set, or before you start bossing people around, make sure that you have done your research, trained yourself, and you're prepared as a director. Other people's time, their efforts, their talents are involved. Make sure that you give them something to be proud of. The last thing I want to say to anybody out there that wants to make movies, that wants to get in this industry, that wants to do media, content, film, whatever, it doesn't matter. Be confident in yourself, love what you do, put your heart, mind, and soul into every piece of artwork that you create. And don't let anybody else tell you who you are or what your art is. I'm Christopher Bray, writer, director, producer, actor for the CMB Studios original feature film, our first one, Trauma. I love y'all. Go make a movie.
Another one, March 30th. CMB Studios, Trauma's old lady. Girl, I feel it.
I'm prolific, so gifted. I'm the type that's gon' go get it, no kidding. Breaking down a switch in front of your building. Sitting on the steps, feeling no feelings. Last night it was a cold killer. You gotta keep the devil in his hole, nigga. But you know how it go, nigga. I'm front line every time it's on, nigga. 100 proof flow, run and shoot pro. 458 drop, playing bulletproof soul. Every few shows, I just buy some new gold.